Those cats' cafes. The fence.
I made it.
Tell the story on.
Wrapped up, madam is making. She's on the second floor.
Now it can be damp mopped on and it dries in only half the time. To that bright acrylic.
Good evening, Radcliffe.
Tougher than wax shine.
Madam, what a pleasant surprise.
New, improved future. Same tough shine in half the time.
BCTV, a best dish show.
Good morning. There's a story on Canadian Press this morning, and I can almost give you dollars to donuts that it will be denied, modified, and may disappear. But it's so good, and Canadian Press is so reliable, that I must draw it to your attention. It quotes Le Soleil, big French-Canadian newspaper, saying that a secret government study is considering for the Speech from the Throne establishing a giant youth camp to combat high unemployment of people under 25 years of age. The preliminary study for the camp proposes that 70,000 youngsters between 18 and 24 would attend this camp in its first year of operation. This is to get the unemployed off the streets, perhaps. And it's going to cost about, in this secret study, $260 million. Where 10,000 youngsters at a time could study languages and Canadian history courses, as well as taking part in an intensive physical exercise program for 7 weeks, probably led, just like they used to do in a certain country before the war, by none other than our new Minister of Fitness and Amateur Sport, the indomitable, tough, slim, trim, Senator Ray Perot. Now, on this day, there's always confusion about Pierre's age, but let's bring up his picture and wish Pierre Elliott Trudeau a happy, happy birthday. Now, Charlie Lynch says he's 63. I'm almost sure he's 64. Again, I wouldn't bet on it. Because when he first appeared into the political scene, there was confusion. His biog at the time when he was running for prime minister showed him 2 years younger than he really was. Mind you, he looks 20 years younger than one other 64-year-old whom you're looking at right now. But on this happy day for Pierre's birthday, one really must praise him for his accomplishments. His accomplishments. His accomplishments. Now, let's see what he's done. He's destroyed the Liberal Party, federally and provincially. He's coming up to a deficit this year, which ain't going to be $10 billion or $20 billion. It's going to be $30 billion. What else has he done? Oh, yes, he's created partially, of course, you can't blame everything on Pierre, about between 1.4 and 1.6 million unemployed in the country. He's shattered the oil industry under the National Energy Program. He's destroyed any potential leadership to take his place if and when he ever decides to go within his own party. But I'm very attracted to this proposition of the camp for 10,000 youngsters, whether they shall do physical jerks, study multiculturalism, practice their bilingualism, and be kept off the streets at maybe $5 a day plus their keep, and no drugs whatsoever. If this were set up, there wouldn't be one single scandal story about the place. Let me think. It was Roosevelt, the man who said, "We have nothing to fear but fear itself," whereas many of us now feel we have nothing to fear but Trudeau himself, who started the WPA and the Tennessee Valley Authority. And in British Columbia, we were famous in the 30s for our camps for the jobless, where they got 10 cents a day. And in Hitler's Germany, of course, they had strength through joy. And on the door of the camps, it said, "Arbeit macht frei." Work makes free. So let's look forward to this innovative, productive idea, presently germinating in the seeds of the great liberal brains, the guys who bailed out Dome and the banks. Let's let germinate, and we'll say with many happy birthdays to Pierre and a very positive attitude, "We love you, Pierre." And the slogan for this camp must be, "Strength and fitness through joy, multiculturalism, and bilingualism." Well, I suppose I'm just falling into the old trap of attacking our leaders because I had that little, tiny, perfect fellow on yesterday, fathering him and whatnot. But really, I'm inclined to believe that what I say is somewhat true. Now, this morning, very serious topic. And last weekend again, film up, there was another demonstration of disaster and tragedy on the highways. This is the latest one. This was in Surrey on Saturday night. A head-on collision left two people dead. Charges are still pending. But while police complete their investigation, but as is not unusual in cases like this, you can see the case of beer in the backseat of the car that was involved in the accident that killed two innocent people. And here this morning I have Sally Gribble of M.A.D.D. and Bobette of S.A.D.D. Sally is Mothers Against Drunken Driver, and Bobette is Students Against Drunken Drivers. Now, also on the program this morning, as an information matter, because there are murmurs of dissent among the teaching profession, not about professional days this time, but about the new social studies curriculum for BC schools. And here to explain it to us this morning is Glenn Wall, who is an ADM, an Assistant Deputy Minister, in Van der Zandt's Department of Education. But first off the top this morning, everything she does causes trouble and makes news. The woman is Holt, Simma Holt, and she's created a fascinating mystery, beautifully written, about the other Mrs. Diefenbaker. That's Edna. Simma Holt first, after the break. John Diefenbaker was an unforgettable character, perhaps the most unforgettable character some of us have ever met. But Simma Holt has crafted a good book on the mystery of Dief's first wife, the other Mrs. Diefenbaker. And she says that Edna May Brower Diefenbaker now lies forgotten in a prairie grave. Now, Simma Holt, let's be quite honest. All of his second wife was by his side and his consort for all the years I can virtually remember. And surely it'd be quite normal for a man like Diefenbaker, a man of great pride and pomposity in many ways, not ever to mention his first wife, just as a matter of good public policy. Why do you make a mystery? Document your case making a mystery, which has been, your book has been criticized somewhat, about the other Mrs. Diefenbaker.
Anyone of status and standards in Canada has praised the book, I must say, and I'm very proud of that. And I've just come off a national tour.
That's a real good crack. Anyone of status and standards. In other words, those who criticize your book are a bunch of illiterate finks.
Well, they have done nothing in their life. One who is hit Diefenbaker's biographer, who is trying to live off Diefenbaker for the rest of his life, has a vested interest in this book never appearing because it blows his biography into the, you know, it shows that it's wrong. The book is written probably inspired by John Diefenbaker himself. If John Diefenbaker hadn't had that show funeral, but even if he'd had that funeral and quietly been buried beside Olive and Beechwood as they had agreed on, Nobody would have even thought of Edna. The day after that burial, all across Canada, people were phoning newspapers. They were writing letters to each other, some of which I have. And I got the phone call the morning after telling me from Catherine Collins, a woman who taught with Edna. And she said, you know, you have always been fair and just. Why don't you do something about John Diefenbaker's first wife? And I said, what wife? And all across Canada, I found that people did not know about Edna, except in Prince Albert and Saskatoon. And then in even the young people of Prince Albert and Saskatoon didn't know about her. And in Ottawa, a few knew. And that's why I was lucky. There were still people who remembered Edna,
but
and I was able to find
them. Get back to the crux of the mystery. First of all, I remember, it's in your book too, how Diefenbaker prepared his own state funeral. Am I correct?
Yes, he did. And I don't think Graham Glockling, who was the Secretary of State planning it, expected him to live so long after he announced to him that he was entitled to a state funeral. And I felt Graham Glockling did what was probably right in saying to him, Mr. Diefenbaker, you're entitled to a state funeral. But for 5 years, Diefenbaker changed the plans and rewrote the plans, and at the last moment decided that he was going to be buried on the beside his own monument, to which he bequeathed money, the Diefenbaker Center on a hill overlooking the Saskatchewan River. Right below is what is known as Devil's Dip. But in either case, he planned it there. He's got a stone that's identical. He really copied the great. The stone is identical to Churchill's, and if you notice, his biography is designed in the same style of Churchill.
Now, where was Olive, wife number two, buried?
Olive was buried in Beechwood in a beautiful plot that they had arranged. It was under a great big maple tree, and they had planned together that they would be buried side by side there. Olive was disinterred and brought there after almost 3 years in her grave.
And brought to where?
To Saskatoon, to the side of the hill, and buried there.
So John lies there with his second wife.
And the people say you can almost see Woodlawn, where Edna is buried, 4 feet below the rest of the Diefenbaker family in the Diefenbaker plot, in a plot for four. She is buried below the rest of the family. John had promised and planned as she was dying of leukemia on February 1951.
Edna, wife number one,
would be buried, and John would be buried on top of her. John could not be away from his women. First his mother, then Edna, then Olive. And he had to be close to them. And Charles Lynch told me that he actually went in search of information about his afterlife. Would Olive be reunited with Mr. Palmer, who she married and who died when she was very young? Would Edna claim him? Would Olive claim him? He actually went in search of answers. He was terrified that Olive and he would not be reunited. He was buried close to her. But he originally planned to be buried on top of Edna. Instead, his brother, who was somewhat slow, possibly retarded, was buried on top of her.
The theme of your book is, the central mystery is that Diefenbaker erased, you say, nearly every trace of his first wife.
Quite deliberately and methodically.
How?
Well, he wept, mourned for her. It's a love story, Jack. He mourned for her, and she died in his arms. He mourned almost a year after. He was still seen weeping for Edna a year after. Then when a new woman came into his life, Olive, he stopped mourning for Edna, and within a year, Edna's name was erased completely from the Parliamentary Guide, which is the encyclopedia of Canadian parliamentary history and all its personalities. And then he moved on to spread the word that Edna was sick. His aides are continuing to say Edna had an alcohol problem. That was what I was told by John Monroe, who's supposed to be a historian.
John Monroe.
That's the John Monroe who was the curator of the Diefenbaker Center.
Right.
And who expected to tell the real story of John Diefenbaker. As a matter of fact, he's the one that wrote the obit.
And Edna did not have a drinking problem.
She didn't have a drinking problem. She didn't have a drug problem. She didn't have any problem. She wasn't ill. She had a brief period of illness during the menopause. She went through a period where she was depressed and went through menopausal depression because her hair, she thought, was falling out. She was no longer beautiful. She was going through what many, many men and women go through and today accept as part of a change. And then she was in hospital for 6 weeks before she died.
What about Dave's own biography? How much attention does it pay to the first wife?
There are three references to her in about seven paragraphs. in 900 pages, three books of biography. But there was a professor, a very eminent professor, at the opening of the Diefenbaker Center that said people take liberties with history, none more than John Diefenbaker.
Was she a good consort? Was she well liked? Did she appear much in public?
Oh, Edna was everywhere, and it's said that without Edna, John would never have got elected. He was a loner. He was fearful of going into among people. He just didn't have the ingredients. He lost every election that he tried. He tried provincial, he tried federal, he tried civic, and from 1925 to 1940, he was a loser, a loner. He didn't like to be among people. His great ability, the only ability he had for politics, was he loved a stage, aloof from people, like you, Jack. You know, you stand back and you're safe from people as long as you're on stage. No,
but
I'm kidding.
I know you
but
are.
You know the style of acting that is safe. You're on
so
stage.
So you've taken this great conservative hero, Diefenbaker, and he's still a conservative hero, and you've painted a picture of a kind of selfish man who deliberately wiped his wife, number one, out from his previous recorded life.
But Jack,
is that right?
Jack, first of all, history has made him part of his own writing of history. We may find that much of the history is lost. His documents are lost of the history he doesn't want. He doesn't want Edna. She was expunged. Who knows what else is destroyed in his papers?
Did you write this to embarrass the conservatives, the old line conservatives?
I never even thought I'd discover Diefenbaker. I knew Diefenbaker. I never thought, I knew what I was going to find. I didn't even expect to write a book the day after the funeral. I just was curious to know who this woman was. As far as Diefenbaker having the truth told about him, Jack, why should history be built on myths and fables?
Simma Holt, still a liberal.
Oh, I was never, they called me the opposition in the Liberal Party. I've never been a good partisan politician.
After the break. Never thought Simma Holt would write this kind of history book, but she was fascinated by the fact that in all the years she'd known John Diefenbaker, she didn't know that he'd had a first wife, Edna. Just give me the facts again. How old was he when he married Edna?
He married Edna when he was about 34 years old. She was 30.
How long were they married until
she
died?
They were married 22 years. I expected to find a woman married 2 or 3 years of no significance.
Did they have any children?
No, they didn't. And he blamed her for that after she was dead. Part of the contempt he heaped on her. And in fact, he didn't want children until she was 45. Then when she went through this menopausal depression, the doctors recommended that it would be good for her to have children, and John persisted, and at that time she knew what she was married to, and she said, and bring another John Diefenbaker into the world, a man whose destiny is decided when he was born. And the thing that happened was her friend said, well, at least half of it will be, a doctor said, half of it will be yours.
Are you telling me that she just didn't like John Diefenbaker before she died?
I think after the shock treatment, when he signed papers, even though he knew there was that much wrong with her, he signed papers on the advice of the doctors, and it was experimental then. I think there was a lot of bitterness. I talked to her niece last night who lived with her, and everybody's asked, what would have happened today if Edna had lived in this freer time? And
it's normal for an ordinary person, if they marry a second time, not to stuff the memories of the first wife down the second wife's throat.
They didn't.
What really is so different about this?
It wasn't a case of stuffing it down their throat, but he could have forgotten her if he wanted. But why set out to expunge her, destroy every record of her, minimize her, and in the end of her life, do the most degrading thing, which is saying that if he had married Olive, he would have had children, and his life would have been different. Indeed, his life would have been different. Olive would not have pushed him. Edna was everybody who knew Edna said that she had the capacity to make him champion of the underdog, remember names, care about people, and seem to care about people. She was considered the greatest PR worthy of Madison Avenue on the Hill, and every reporter.
And this was when he came out of the West as a virtual unknown into the House of Commons, was it not?
That's right. And Edna was from a very famous prairie family, very outgoing, and loved by everybody. She could walk into Jimmy Gardner's office, who was the Minister of Agriculture, get information from her, from him. Jimmy Gardner said that outside of his wife, she was the greatest influence in his life. Mackenzie King would stop and talk to her and said that if I had seen him first, John would never have got her. She could talk to Saint Laurent. They stopped and talked in the halls with her. She was the most loved personality on Parliament Hill. Mm-hmm. And she was described by Douglas Howe as an unelected MP for Lake Centre.
Did John, you seem to indicate in your book that John lacked social graces except for Edna's tuition, is that correct?
Completely. He and Elmer were raised in a homestead by a mother who was domineering and very, very much made mama's boys out of them. And he didn't know how to walk into a room. I was told by a Vancouver cabinet minister in the Diefenbaker government that it was known John could not walk into a room alone, even after he was married to Edna. He would sit in his room and read a book and then only come in when she had guests, when the dinner was on the table, and walk out.
The woman called Beatrice Bly from Ottawa wrote to the Globe and Mail to object to some of the material in your book, and she mustn't let the reviews, the favorable reviews, go by without protest. Said that Mrs. Diefenbaker's life with John was no secret, and that you quoted her on CBC interviews saying that Edna was sick most of her life, which is simply not true. She, that you called Beatrice and asked for an interview, which I, Beatrice Bly, declined to give. And she says, I have often wondered why people malign public persons after they have gone and what purpose it serves.
Well,
Simma Holt.
Beatrice Bly was his last secretary. I phoned her, and you know, Jack, I take notes of everything. Beatrice Bly is part of the thing that is continuing after John's death. She did, and I in fact have my notes, say she became angry, in fact, and she said Edna was sick all her life. I said, did you know her? She said, no. She came in 10 years later. Beatrice Bly, if you read her story of the train trip, you'd think she was the queen of the funeral service. Beatrice Bly has a...
Oh, yeah, they carried his body in a railway car.
And she was always, always beside governor generals. But Beatrice Bly and a few others are continuing this story. I did not try to interview her. In fact, she's the sister of Gray of Gray Publishing, and she was visiting her brother over in Vancouver Island. I was 20 minutes away. I didn't even bother going over to see her, because Beatrice Bly had nothing. She's Betty Eli, as she's known. She's not Beatrice Bly, Betty Eli. She was.
She has a different opinion from you.
No, but she didn't know Edna. I didn't want to interview people that would give me hearsay.
Yeah.
Her information, I interviewed 300 people, most of them who personally knew Edna, had letters, had information. I didn't want hearsay.
It is a dramatic story, though. He spent 5 years preparing his own state funeral.
Yes, and of course, that's the first chapter of the book.
And then his body was taken by rail after this incredible state funeral in Ottawa to the Diefenbaker Center in Saskatchewan, is
that right?
That's right.
And when he was...
And her body was brought from her grave, Olive's body.
Flown over, and
she
was
buried
lying...
with him.
Yeah, she was lying beside his grave when his
and
body
Edna,
was...
And Edna, the woman who didn't want to produce another John Diefenbaker, is buried in a lonely grave. How many months? Not a lonely grave.
You can see it from the hillside. They say it's in Woodlawn in
You like John Diefenbaker.
Yeah, he was a really good friend. I was very
disappointed. You still like him?
I'm ambivalent about him now. I was very... He used to fight Jim Jerome for me. And the day that Fox made his great speech in the house that was supposedly so destroying, John came right over to me and for some reason or other wanted to talk to me about it and was just heartbroken because he loved young men. He loved them as sons and proteges. And he said he might as well have put a rock on and carved it all in stone on the lawn of Parliament Hill. And he used to do those things. He'd come to talk to me about many, many things, but not once did he mention a first wife.
By and large, the reaction has been warm and good to you.
Oh, fascinating. And the young people are the biggest surprise of all. They are fascinated by this woman.
Your first book, we had another name for it, was Terror in the Name of God.
Right.
Right. Don't give the other name for it.
Oh, no, that's your name.
Wasn't my name.
You're not a decent, you're tall decent when you're joking, Jack.
Then you wrote, what, three or four other books?
I wrote Sex and the Teenage Revolution, which is still a very valid book about the destruction of children, and the third was The Devil's Butler.
This is your best book?
I liked it best. And you know, the funny thing about it is, you know, I've written about crime, mayhem, killers, motorcycle gangs, but because I've written a biography on a woman and am a woman, they now call me a feminist author. It's how fast it takes to get a label, but maybe I'll stop being labeled the other thing.
I hope you make a million on it, Simma Holt. Next, we're going to deal with the social studies curriculum through Glenn Wall, the Assistant Deputy Minister of Education of Victoria. Best of luck, Simma. Your hair looks very nice today.
Thank you.
That's its natural color, or are you dyeing it gray?
No, it's natural, just like yours. Which
how old are you? Holt, how old are you?
Same age as Pierre, only 4 years less. I hit the big six.
You're 60.
Admit it. Oh, yeah, I'm an old bat.
Don't look a day more than 59.
Oh, thanks, old buddy. You don't look a day under 70.
Next is the new social studies curriculum. Got your bloody name.
You're 60.
It's all right.
It's all
right. No, he says it's the first time he hasn't snarled at me.
Pat is worried about your mic because of what's happening.
It's up well.
Seems to be all right.
Two segments before phones, won't you?
One or two.
What's the matter, Pat? Where do you want to go to phones next?
Oh, there's a... Where's my little page? Oh, here it is, here. This one. Nice of you to come over, Glenn.
I'm looking forward to it, Jack.
But Anders out during the budget cuts. Well, that's going to be another dog's breakfast next year. The moment I saw that teachers in the BC, or at least officials of the BC Teachers Federation, don't like this new social studies curriculum, which is being introduced through, from kindergarten through grade 11, I asked Glenn Wall, an assistant deputy minister, to come over and tell me, social studies, one of the key parts of any curriculum in any school, and you have made changes which have caused murmurs of dissent. Have you revolutionized this program and changed the study of social studies in any radical way?
No, we haven't, and the concern that we have is that if one is to believe the recent controversy, it would appear that the Ministry of Education has suddenly imposed upon the teachers of the province an entirely new curriculum in social studies, which is not factual. As far back as 1975, the teachers of the province indicated their dissatisfaction with the curriculum offerings, Jack, and the attempt now is to bring that together using teachers to assist us in putting it together.
Now, a couple of basic things, first of all. Were the teachers in any way consulted on this new social studies program?
They indeed were. The teachers formed the largest group putting this program together.
Would that be half a dozen teachers or a couple
no,
hundred teachers?
No, we had 75 teachers directly involved and up to 300 throughout the province who were involved at one time or another in assessing what we were doing and where we were going.
And I hate the word, but did you come to a consensus on what the new program would be?
Not fully. You never will with a controversial subject area as social studies is. Everyone opposed to what we were doing are basically opposed because their own particular areas of interest perhaps have not been hit hard enough.
Not hit hard enough.
That's right.
Now, have you a new set of social studies books, which textbooks, which go with the this new program?
Well, we have textbooks which will go with the grades 1 to 3. The contract has been awarded to a BC publisher. Grades 4 to 11 has not yet been awarded, and the plan is to phase this in over the next 4 years.
But you will have new textbooks to meet your new curriculum?
Yes, we will.
What was wrong with the old curriculum?
The old curriculum basically was repetitious. Students were very often faced with the same subject matter from 1 year's end to the next without ever having teachers perhaps in some instances follow through to see what had been covered, children coming home saying, but we took that last year. The repetition was probably the worst.
Repetition by classroom teachers from the guidelines, and you have guidelines.
Well, the guidelines were there, but they were weak. They were not good, and the teachers were quite correct in saying that something indeed had to be done.
Which is the most important one, grade 11, grade 10, 11? Are these the important ones? Is that when you've modernized the curriculum?
Well, if modernized is a word to use, yes, it would be at the secondary levels.
Now, what's this going to cost, this new social studies curriculum and these times of restraint?
Well, the newspaper articles indicated that $12 million would be spent on textbooks, and indeed that is a fair estimate. But what the articles don't say is that that is spread out over 4 years, and if we went with the old textbooks and reprinted them, there are some 87 from grades 1 to 11, 87 authorized books out there on the market right now.
How many will the authorized books will there be under the new textbooks?
Well, with 11 grades, with it being compulsory, there'll be 2 to 3 books per grade, so we're looking closer to 30 rather than the 87.
Now, that's a silly question, perhaps, but you do provide the students...
The books are provided by the Ministry of Education.
To the students.
To the students throughout the province. Students.
All right, now, I've got in front of me the old studies and the new studies.
Yes.
Let's take Canadian history in grade 10. You've got the study of Canadian and other types of governments and laws. That was too broad, was it?
It was.
What will they study instead? What are your suggested curriculum guides for this?
Well, we will instead study the development of governments not only in Canada but in other countries of the world. The teachers, again, will be given an opportunity to do this or to select the development of a modern state, for example. But
we will
be stressing the Canadian content, yes.
But you could do a selected study on the rise of Hitler, for instance.
Yes, you could do.
Or revolutionary change in the USSR.
Yes.
Was that done before?
Not to the degree and organization that it will be done now.
Well, that's good, isn't it?
I think it is.
Let's go back to grade 9, the study of resources in different economies. That was modern European history, was it?
That's right.
I noticed in this one, for instance, you're going to have an overview of economic development of BC and Western Canada and a selected study. What does that mean? Does that mean a course on the potential for Western Canada?
Yes, it does.
Was that done before?
It was done in a Canadian context, but not so much a Western Canada context.
Now, I see in grade 8 you're going to take, last time it was a kind of third world study, wasn't
correct,
it?
Correct, yes.
How are you going to modernize that one?
Well, we are giving teachers the option to follow through on everything from the major influences in the Middle Ages through the Greek-Roman period.
Overview of immigration to Canada, 1642
yes.
to 1850.
Yes.
And then I see, and this is probably where some of the remarks about racism come in, you're going to study the development of multiculturalism and make studies of native peoples or an Asian or European cultural group not previously studied.
That's correct.
Does that modernize it?
It does to the degree and to the extent that certainly in the schools in a large metro area such as Vancouver, we have so many cultures represented, and we would like to emphasize that, and indeed it does modernize it, yes.
So what you've done really is taken these broad social studies topics and been more specific in the direction to the classroom
exactly.
teacher.
Exactly. However, I must add that the classroom teacher will still be given a great deal of leeway. They do not have to follow to the nth degree, everything that is there. We have only provided an expected list of topics to be covered.
The critics say that the children won't come out with any coherent image of Canadian or world history. In other words, you're not going to do the historical chronology by dates such as old-timers like mine did.
I hope not.
You're dropping all that, the Battle of Hastings or the Plains of Abrams? Or
I think probably we wouldn't drop the Battle of Hastings, but we would drop the emphasis on memorizing the dates in which it occurred. How many bushels of wheat have been exported in any one given year to China? Not very interesting.
In other words, they won't be so good on trivia, but they might be better on the broad concepts of what has happened to this country.
Exactly.
Are politics as such, this hasn't been raised for years, taught in classroom? Teachers are fully free to discuss political philosophies of any kind as
yes,
they,
they
wish
are.
At any time.
Yes, they are. And it, teachers will obviously... teach all concepts and not zero in on any
is
one.
Is there any area in your new curriculum where, for instance, you could do, as must be done, an intelligent guide for youngsters on separatism?
Yes, there is.
Where's that?
We would have that in the grade 6 curriculum, and we feel that if you're going to deal with the Confederation unit, how can you possibly understand the separatist problem unless you dealt with Confederation, and that's how we deal with that.
Now, will that... Oh. Listen, I'm going to take some. I believe we've got a couple of teachers who are going to phone with specific questions for Glenn. You don't mind, do
no,
you?
No, that's fine.
And let's take these teachers now, and because my knowledge of this, you could really, like Trudeau's achievements in the country, you could put in the head of a pin after the break. Glenn Walls, Assistant Deputy Minister from Victoria in the Education Department. Now, is this the first time you have gone out on this $12 million over 4 years to bring in your own approved textbooks on social studies?
Yes, that's correct.
And will that be for the whole thing from kindergarten through grade?
From grade 1 through to grade 11.
At the moment, you've only got those done for the kindergarten 1, 2, 3 or something.
That's right. Grades 1 to 3, they've been piloted and
is that not significant? Is that not what might be annoying many teachers at the government is writing its own social studies books, in effect.
I think it should annoy the teachers if that was the case, but that's not the case. The teachers are very heavily involved in the entire process.
Who wrote these books? I mean, not names, but they were done, written by Canadian authors for
us. Oh, yes, yes. A lot of them, the majority of them from Eastern Canada, some of them American versions that have been Canadianized, and we thought that it's time that we had something that is more apropos of the local scene.
Okay, where is George Major? 1244. George Major is a social studies teacher in Chilliwack, and he can ask better questions than I can. Go ahead, George.
Hello there, Jack.
Morning.
I have a few questions here that I'd like to mention. The first question is, how can the ministry really justify the large sums of money being spent on this new, I think would suggest a very expensive curriculum, when there's basically a cheaper, more effective alternative available?
Well, first of all, Jack, as I mentioned to you earlier, the cost of these textbooks, the $12 million over the next 4 years, is indeed significant. However, if we did not go with these textbook revisions, the cost could be as high as $20 million to reprint the 87 versions of authorized and prescribed texts which are presently out there.
Well, there's you must be aware, of course, there are texts already on the market which the government could purchase, I'm sure, at a cheaper version, a cheaper price, rather than starting from scratch and producing a set of textbooks simply for the BC market. The BC taxpayers are going to have to pick up all the cost of these books. The volume is simply not there.
What about the content, though, George? There are 500,000 students in our public school system, I'm told. Do you have any objection to the form of curriculum? Do you think they're in some way damaging the competence of a student in the long run?
Yes, we think that in diluting and debasing the traditional basics of geography and history, this new curriculum will lend itself well to opinionating, preaching, vague thinking, and propagandizing. In fact, in even one case, it seems to even encourage some of the ideas of Western separatism.
Well, what do you say to that? He says that you're debasing social studies. Wiping out geography, or what's that effect?
Indeed, we're not wiping it out. We're bringing it in with the history under the umbrella of social studies. And what better way, for example, to study Canadian history and geography than by, for example, looking at the English and French Canadian explorers as they landed in this country? And we're tying it in. It's
George
being brought together.
George seems to be afraid of advocacy. If you're studying the Canadian Constitution, which is part of Canadian history,
yes.
and the rise of separatism. I presume you'll explore both Quebec and Western Canada.
Yes, exactly.
And you're afraid of advocacy by the teachers, George, are you?
It's not so much advocacy by the teachers. Take, for instance, the grade 9 unit that you were mentioning a few moments ago on Western Canada. As it's now presented, it's presented, I think, in a very sloppy manner. The assumptions that are there basically look like simply a list of grievances that, you know, any Western Canadian concept party member could agree with. And in one version of the curriculum that came out, teachers were then encouraged, at the top of the questions, I remember, to ask then the question, should Western Canada then separate? There was no encouragement, for instance, in this unit to compare Western Canada to other parts of Canada.
Just a minute. Do the textbooks suggest questions that should be asked of students?
No, it will not. It will not suggest questions that should be asked of students as to whether or not there should be a Western Canada concept.
Is there anything wrong with a teacher starting a debate in school by saying that we're going to look at Western separatism, the possibility thereof, and discuss it?
No.
What's wrong with that, George?
There's nothing wrong with it per se, but it has to be put in a broader context than it is, seems to be said in the curriculum now. And students, you know, don't tend to see things in black and white. You and I, and I'm sure most of our viewers could get the broader picture. But if you go for those list of assumptions there in the grade 9 section, and if a student learns those, you know, there's only one thing they could assume. Well, let's get out of Canada. Here we're being, our raw materials and resources and whatnot are being sent out of the country.
Okay, Glenn, can you respond to that?
I certainly can. Let's not forget that this is just an expected list of topics to be covered. This is not such a tightly prescribed course of study that it precludes any teacher in the province from expanding on his or her views in the classroom. This is not, we are not quoting line and verse of where you should be by what week in the school year. You still have option time available to you.
George, will you teach this new curriculum or do you really object to it?
We'll probably teach it, and groan as we do. It's part of the job. But we have some questions about it.
Good, and I'm much obliged for your call. Go ahead, please, to Glenn Walls. Glenn Wall. What are you?
Hello.
That's you.
Yes, I am a parent, and I'm rather disillusioned at the end product. I have a son that graduated this year, and I chatted with his friends, all graduated the same graduating class, and asked them some pertinent questions to find out what the hell they knew out of the school system in Vancouver. And one word I mentioned was the Magna Carta. You know, neither one of the, it was about seven of them, could give me an answer what the Magna Carta was. In fact, I am rather disillusioned. I haven't read the so-called new text as a parent. I have a daughter that's going into grade 10 now. But I'll tell you one thing. I'll scream bloody blue murder if it is not up to date in regards to a damn good course, because one thing I will tell you, I went through the Vancouver school system in the 40s and in the 50s, and hell, I knew more in grade 9 in social studies than the kids graduating out of grade 12 today.
Mr. Wall, I sometimes see in my most cynical moments that some youngsters might know Hitler's name, but they wouldn't know his first name. Now, this is a man who has the same kind of feeling. Magna Carta, I suppose, is one of our linchpins of freedom for land barons.
Listen, this is exactly the reason why the Ministry of Education feels that we need the revisions to bring these things together so that teachers are not going their separate ways, so the repetition factor that I mentioned earlier is not happening.
All right, I'm going to test every high school student next year and what Magna Carta is and what Hitler's first name was.
Great.
Thank you, parent. More with Glenn Wall after the break. Maybe when we see the new books, our hair might stand on end, but we have Glenn Wall's assurance that these are reasonable, competent, skilled, up-to-date modern books.
You have that assurance.
On the telephone, I have John Church, who's the Acting Director of Professional Development for the Teachers Federation. John, would you express any doubts, misgivings, or ask questions that you want to in public with Glenn Wall?
Sure, I will. Thanks, Jack. Good morning, Glenn.
Morning, John.
I don't know whether you saw the story that was in last night's Sun, that quoted figures in terms of reaction, Glenn, that indicated that there'd been a 37% favorable response and about 25% unfavorable response. I had one concern about that, Glenn, and that was the fact that I think that was based on a total number of reactions of only 95, 74 group reactions and 21 individual teachers from the period of April to June of 1980. And I don't think that that kind of reaction in a very short period of time when teachers are finishing the year really would indicate the degree of support that the story in the Sun suggested.
Well, John, I haven't studied the statistics as to how many teachers like or dislike the social
right.
studies curriculum. I do know this, that we have piloted the grades 1 to 3 program in 6 school districts with 26 teachers.
Right.
And I think, too, that if you check with the Primary Teachers Association, you'll find that they were very enthusiastic about the results.
Well, the kind of reaction that I've got, Glenn, and I'd like your response to this, has been that primary teachers basically are quite happy that there is some concern at the grade 4 to 6 level, and that secondary teachers, by and large, have been very concerned.
Well, John, you know that the grades 4 to 11 segments have not been finalized. They will be done over the next 4 years. The grades 1 to 3, the books are being done. The consultation process has been enacted with the teachers. We would hope that they would continue to cooperate with us. We don't intend to have desk-bound bureaucrats sitting in Victoria doing this. We need teacher assistance and support, and I'm sure we'll get it.
John, what do you think of the content? Anything hairy about the content you'd like to complain about?
Okay. One of the major concerns I have, Glenn, and this is focusing particularly on 7 to 11, is in terms of the history. It seems to me that if a history is properly conceived and organized and taught, it provides the best structure for giving students a unified sense of their own culture, a sense of their own roots, an understanding of
Agreed.
The possibilities of various cultural differences. And I think that in terms of the outline that is provided, that opportunity is not there.
Okay.
It's the fragmented, episodic approach.
Well, John, you said it yourself, the outline that has been provided, that's indeed all it is. And there's still room for movement in here. There's still room for consultation. And again, the grades 4 to 11 have not been finalized. It's not carved in stone. And we again would welcome consultation.
And you say that it
okay,
might...
Okay, well, let's push this one step further, Glenn. As you know, last year the RA passed a motion asking the ministry to start in effect again. And it was primarily in terms of the secondary program. How far is the ministry going to be open for consultation and having a really serious look at the 7 to 11 program?
We will have a serious look at it. We would hope all of us, and I'm sure you're the same, John, that we don't have to start all over again. And I would hope, too, that the teacher's decision not to assist in curriculum development and to sit on committees will not be...
let me get that. You said that the teachers... John, now let me ask that issue. Has the BCTF or any teachers decided not to assist and have talks on the new social studies curriculum? Has such a decision been made, John?
Well, such a decision has been made, but it was only made 2 weeks ago, and so I don't think either we or probably you, Glenn, are aware of changes that have occurred yet. You probably have not been doing anything in social studies, for example.
But what decision was made and by whom not to cooperate with the new curriculum?
Well, this was a motion passed by the Representative Assembly of the BCTF, which is made up of representatives of all the local associations around the province.
Okay, I've got that. Is that decision going to hold, John?
Is that Glenn's talking about the need for consultation, you know, and that's an important aspect of this.
Well, did you know of this decision last fall by the delegates to this assembly, apparently?
This was only a couple of weeks ago.
We're actually talking about two different things, I think, aren't we, Glenn?
Oh.
We're talking about, one, the motion that was passed last year about asking the ministry to discard the program and to start again. And then we're talking about a second motion that was passed, and this motion was passed because of the government's restraint program and the kinds of pressures that are being placed on teachers.
Oh, I see.
But John, that second motion that was passed indicated that teachers would not sit on curriculum committees, correct?
That's correct.
Does that disturb you, Glenn Wall?
Well, it disturbs me because we need the teachers to assist us to do a proper curriculum. Again, it shouldn't be done by ministry staff only.
In other words, you do not accept that this is fragmented episodic tuition and that the teacher has the full capacity to meld the subjects together as he wishes.
Of course.
And are you going to get together and get the teachers to withdraw this decision not to sit on curriculum committees? Curriculi committees?
We certainly hope that they will assist us.
Well, I'm glad to get it out in public anyway, John.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Fragmented, episodic, properly melded together.
I'd like that, but that will not be part of the new curriculum.
It will not be part of the new curriculum. Let's get a parenti. Go ahead, please.
Hello, Mr. Church.
No, this is Mr. Wall.
Oh, Mr. Wall, excuse me. As a parent, I like to have my children raised in the school curriculum with a very deep sense of loyalty to their own country. And the only way that this can be done is by having a real in-depth study of Canadian history plus Canadian geography. We have the second largest country in the world. There is plenty of geography in this country where our children could learn. Also, we have a history that dates way back to even pre-Columbus times, and yet our children aren't aware of that. Now, as a parent, I'm very disturbed about the introduction of the Western Canadian concept, because if you remember in Quebec, one of the first onslaughts was with the children there to familiarize them with the separatist concept. And I can see in your curriculum that's the direction that the education system is taking in this province.
Okay, so leave it there. That's a good point. This man is afraid that they won't have the proper study and that it might, in effect, encourage separatism.
No, I don't think that that is at all a...
Surely the teachers reflect, by and large, whether we like it or not, the same proportion of political or social feelings as the rest of us do.
I would like to think so.
So
I do think so.
That's our guard against hysterical teaching or extravagance.
Yes,
is that
it
correct?
Is. That is correct. And I would like to say, too, that you want the Canadian history aspect stressed as never before, and I assure you that particularly in the grade 7 to 11 curriculum, that's exactly what's going to happen. And our critics who claim that that's what's going to happen, we plead guilty and with intent.
Well, Glenn Wall, thank you very much, Assistant Deputy Minister of Education. The proof of the pudding will be in the output, to mix our metaphors a little bit. But for goodness sake, make sure they know Hitler's first name.
We will.
And the Magna, what's it called?
I think it's Carta.
And don't forget Trudeau's Magna Carta, too. My thanks to Glenn Wall. Next, a very sobering program with officials of Mothers Against Drunken Driving, Students Against Drunken Driving, and some of their personal tragedy after the break. A new social phenomenon has been developing in our part of the world. I'm thinking particularly about the Citizens United for Safety and Justice, who started quite an effective organization complaining about the laxness of our system of rehabilitation of people convicted of serious crimes. That's one. Then there's MAD, Mothers Against Drunken Driving, and SAD, Students Against Drunken Driving. And this, too, I think is a kind of expression of individuals' concern, not vigilante action of any kind, but feeling that not enough attention and spotlight is given to social problems such as drinking and driving and the toll on the highways. And I have three people here this morning. I have Sally Gribble. Sally, I'm going to talk to you first. Sally, you founded Mothers Against Drinking Driving.
That's right.
What's it called again?
Mothers Against Drunk Drivers.
Drunk Drivers.
Pretty strong statement.
Was this an original idea of yours, or did you shape it from somewhere else?
No. After Fred was killed last year, Jack,
Fred.
I got in touch. Yeah.
Let's have a look at Fred. How old was Fred?
21.
21. And if you can talk about it, give me a short outline of how he died.
Okay. He was, it was a Sunday afternoon against the times when it's supposed to be the bad times. Fred was out taking pictures with his camera out at Harrison Hot Springs. And he was on his way home for dinner. He'd asked that the roast be rare, and so I had to sort of time it because we'd company from Scotland and they hate rare meat, eh? Mm-hmm. So we kind of watched the time and waited. Anyway, he never made it home. He was hit by this man that made a left turn right in front of him and didn't see him. And
was he walking or driving?
He was driving a motorbike, Jack.
He was on a motorbike.
Yeah. He was wearing a bright orange hypothermia suit. He paid $350 for that before he even bought the motorbike.
And he was instantly killed?
No, he died 7 hours later in the Royal Columbian Hospital.
Now, were there any charges laid on that?
Yeah, there was. We were informed at first by the constable at the scene that there would be criminal negligence causing death. This is after we phoned to let them know that Fred had died. They said there would be criminal negligence charges laid. However, the sergeant decided that there wasn't any point, that the charges would be refusing to take a breathalyzer because he did not cooperate with the police and with impaired driving.
And he was charged and appeared in court, this man,
right,
with impaired and refusing to blow. And did he get a good stiff penalty?
No, we're still waiting a year and a half later. We've been up three times for sentencing. We were up
is
a total
of 8 times. Is he still charged
impaired? Right. He was acquitted of the impaired because the judge said you don't convict on suspicion because he refused to take a breathalyzer. But he has been convicted of the refusing to take a breathalyzer. This is this man's second conviction of refusing, and he had a hit-and-run conviction before that.
And he has been found guilty only of refusing to blow.
That's right, and he's 36 years old.
How long since your boy was killed?
A year and 4 months now.
And you're telling me the man has not even been sentenced on
no,
this comparatively minor charge?
That's right.
Why?
Well, there's been waiting for one precedent after another because that thing come up, you know, with the human rights people that thought you shouldn't have to take a breathalyzer. It was appealed, and it's now gone through that you do have to. Now we're waiting for the fact that some other guy, lawyer, come up and said he didn't want his client to go to jail because the case went by summary and not by indictment. So we have to wait again.
So your boy is killed, and now you've been in court 8 times. And the charge is only refusing to blow, and there hasn't even been a punishment
right
imposed on that for
that's
one reason or another.
That's right. When we got November 18th, they've set a date for November 18th now, only to set a date for sentencing again. So it could go on for
so you started mad.
Yeah, I got in touch with Herr Parkin at the Royal Columbian Hospital because
I felt
I don't do something about this, I'm going to feel guilty for the rest of my life.
How many members have you got?
We've got 200 paid members now, and we've got thousands of supporters, people that have signed our petition.
I'll come back to what you want to do. Now I'm going to speak to, you're a vice president of MAD.
Yes, that's
John
correct.
John Schafer.
Yes.
What made you join MAD, John?
Well, my son was killed just about 2 years ago by a drunk driver who simply drove off the road and struck the boy as he was walking along the road with a companion. I was really dismayed by what I learned in the court procedures.
How old was your boy?
He was 15 years old.
And he was walking?
Yes, he was walking off the road.
Was this in Vancouver?
This was in Maple Ridge on the Dudney Trunk Road.
And tell me what you've learned, how disillusioned you've become, presumably, with what happened. Was anybody charged with your boy's death?
Yes, the man who killed him was charged with failure to have a driver's license. He was fined $35 for that. He was charged with impaired driving, to which he pleaded guilty, and was sentenced to spend 4 months in the Alouette River rehabilitation camp. He was released after 3 months. And the ironic thing is that he was just released from a detoxification center about a week before he killed the boy.
An alcoholic of some description.
Oh, an alcoholic and a criminal of great magnitude.
So your boy gets killed and he gets fined $35 and does 4 months to sober up in Alouette River?
Yes.
Do you feel that was justice in any way?
Oh, I feel that was an insult to the memory of my son and to myself and to all the citizens who through their taxes have to support people of this type. This man was on welfare and his habit was being supported by the general public.
Come back to you, John. Now, Bobette Gourlay, you've started a new organization called
S.A.D.D, which is Students Against Drunk Drivers.
What was the, I hate to ask you, love, but what was the prod that made you do that?
Two friends of mine in the last year now have been killed by drunk drivers. Another one is in the hospital. So we just decided that we'd try to do something about it instead of sitting back and waiting. We are scared to go on the streets.
Yeah, and there was that incident, a friend of yours who was killed stone dead the other night, and another friend badly injured, right?
Right.
There have been no charges laid in that case yet, have there?
No, charges are pending.
Charges are pending on that. I want to talk with my friends from Mothers and Students Against Drunk Drivers after the break. Bobette, which school do you go to?
I go to Palmer Junior Secondary.
When was this accident involving your friends?
There was one April 4th. A drunk driver was playing chicken with a friend of mine. She was going down Ash Street. He hit her with the mirror on the side of his van.
Which he killed?
Yeah, he threw her right into a cement ditch.
Then there was another one just over the weekend.
Then there was one Thursday night. A friend of mine was crossing Gilbert and Granville. She was hit by the drunk driver and dragged 150 yards.
Well, we don't know if he was drunk yet, but charges are pending. That was Michelle, wasn't it?
Michelle Quinnell.
Michelle Quinnell. And how about her friend, your other friend that was with her? She's still
Tammy
in hospital?
Tammy Cote. She's in hospital. She broke her arm in seven places.
And they were walking on the side of the road?
They were walking across a pedestrian.
Across the pedestrian crossing.
That's what upsets me a lot.
What do you, is it possible for you to tell me what you want done? I mean, your frustrations. What would you like to see done?
Some strong, strong method to get drunk drivers off the road is our ultimate goal, Jack. We are realists. We realize that we probably never get every drunk driver off the road. But what we're trying to do is try and create, for God's sake, some public awareness. The people, the citizens are virtually unaware of what goes on in the courts. You know, the real, true, tragic comedy of sitting there wondering what kind of evidence is going to come
out. And watching this being dropped and that being adjourned and...
$300 fine. When would you like to pay it, sir? 3 months. Comes back in 3 months. Poor guy. I'm on welfare. My kids don't have any food, but they always have money for booze. That's the way I look at it.
And we were
going. And it comes first.
We're going to do a story in a couple of days about all the number of fines that are never paid.
Oh, I heard about that one too. Mm. What we want done, Jack, is the people that have the power, the people that have the intelligence and the responsibility to do something that's going to be effective. You know, there are effective ways.
If you took the driver's license away for life and any death on the highway where there was any form of culpable negligence, that might do something, you know.
If somebody thought, I'm going to be a step in the right direction, let's put it like that.
Decent people can do these things too in momentary carelessness or stupidity, but if they knew they were going to lose their driving privilege for life.
Yeah, there's a lot of decent people that wouldn't do it.
That's right. Have you any suggestions, Mr. Schafer?
Well, yes, I feel very strongly, as Sally does, that there does have to be a very strong deterrent, and this has to be issued through the court system. I'm in favor of impounding automobiles that are involved in these accidents, for the duration of the trials, at least, and with a stiff penalty if the automobile belongs to someone else who was not involved, in order to reclaim the automobile. I'm in favor of very strong penalties, work camps if necessary, to drive home the point that drunk driving is an unacceptable social behavior, unacceptable to the general public who have no defense.
Are you in favor of compulsory blood tests?
Definitely, yes, because the blood tests are always taken from the victims. I think the same principle should apply to those who cause these people to become victims. That is,
because driving is not a right. Driving is a privilege.
Definitely.
Hurtling a two-ton vehicle down the road at 65 miles an hour, half-gassed, and yet the police can only take blood if he happens to spill blood in the steering wheel or something, I do believe.
Mm-hmm. Yes, only in that respect. Only in that respect.
In other words, you would go in MAD for compulsory blood samples from everybody suspected of being driving while under the influence of drink.
That's right. They have them in other civilized countries in the world, Jack, and it looks like a responsible step to see what they can do. That's
the way
it
You made a significant comment. The judges who can set the standard of punishment. Surely the punishments are strong enough on paper under the criminal code, are they not?
Mm-hmm. Yes, on paper, and that's where they remain. The judges and the prosecutors and defense lawyers are all of the opinion that killing by drunk drivers is merely a, well, it's of less importance than a parking ticket. It has no consequence to the crime which the man has committed, which is simply drunk driving, and we don't agree with that.
One of the reasons being, of course, that when I've attended many jury trials in the years gone by, right, where a jury refuses to find the guy guilty of criminal negligence for causing death because of their own conscience, they think, oh, goodness, it might have been me.
They put themselves in that person's place. They say, then, but for the grace of God, go I. But we are saying to them, look at our children and say, there, but for the grace of God goes my child or my mother or father. Mm-hmm. We have to somehow reverse that, get that
mind. Even the system recognizes, the judges certainly recognize that drinking driving charges become a plaything for delays, adjournments, excuses, perhaps plea bargaining as well.
Yes, definitely.
Which makes a mockery of any real punishment for a guy who kills while, or a woman who kills while drinking and driving. He's still looking for members.
Oh
yes.
Have you had any decent reactions, say, from Attorney General Williams?
Well, we sort of plagued him for quite some time, and now he's responding, you know.
Reduced the roadside prohibition to 0.05.
That's a responsible thing.
That's better, but yes. You believe it, your life will never be the same again, either any of the three of you.
No, it can't ever be the same again.
And you have the feeling that thought was not only vicious and wicked and horrible and tragic,
but it's accepted.
Accepted.
In society.
Yes.
Your calls to my friends from Mothers Against Drunk Driving, mothers and fathers.
Yes.
Yeah. One of the things, we're going to put brackets in the mothers, so that could be mothers and others.
Against, yes. Yeah. After the break. What's the proportion of families affected by drinking, driving deaths in BC?
1 in 28.
What did the man who killed your son say in court?
He said, I thought I hit a pole, Your Honor. I didn't see the boy, yet he struck him right on the fender, and it was dark. The boy was fully illuminated by the headlights, but he
well,
didn't
I did
see
a, him. Well, I did a notorious one 3 or 4 years ago about a poor woman who was killed in Richmond, River Road, and it was in Richmond. And where they said, we thought we'd hit a garbage can, but they knocked the garbage can 55 feet in the air, so-called, and left the woman there to die. That was the Varhog case. I'll take some calls. 1 in 28 families affected by the toll of drinking on the highways. Physically affected.
Physically affected.
Go ahead, please.
Yes, I'm a little concerned here. How can we expect drunkenness itself to be socially unacceptable when drinking is so sociably acceptable? What I'm getting at is, if you watch the television a lot, there's no advertising bans on alcohol, but there is on, say, cigarettes. So what they're saying is, it's be very careful not to go out and destroy your body with nicotine, but you can go out and drink and destroy someone else's body.
Good point. We just recently started to carry liquor ads.
Yeah, I think that the root of it is the important thing, and we have to show society that this is not acceptable.
Well, one way to show it's not acceptable is really to hammer people who drink and drive.
No, go back a little farther and make it a socially unacceptable thing, such as cigarette smoking.
Well, they scared everybody off cigarettes with lung cancer, but they haven't scared off everybody with cirrhosis of the liver, and I think that problem's a little bit too deep to expect any action on, and civilization's been drinking for 25,000 years.
They've been smoking for that long, too, so why can't we simply...
You raised the point. I don't have an answer,
yes,
do you?
I would like to comment on that, and I wonder how society feels about a doctor who takes a few drinks before he goes in to operate, or a lawyer who gets half stoned on alcohol before he goes to court and presents his case. This is the only area in society where a homicide is acceptable by means of driving a vehicle.
Very good point. If I'm a lawyer drunk in court, I'm in deep trouble at once,
exactly.
Sometimes. If I'm a doctor who operates drunk, I'm for the high jump. I mean,
yes.
At least technically, nobody would argue that I must be for the high jump. But if I'm a drinking driver, refuse to blow. I'm not going to blow. I'm too drunk to blow.
Right. I've talked to a lot of prosecutors who, when you talk to them for an hour and a half, it gradually comes out that it really isn't a crime. You know, they really don't consider that it's a terrible
thing.
They've
also been brainwashed by society, and it could happen to them or anyway.
That's the
yes,
fact that
they
you said it right there, Jack.
Very good point. Go ahead, please, from Abbotsford.
Yes, Jack. I'd just like to say that your program should have a lot more of these people on with the drunk drivers, and it's the answer to the question is so easy. It's enough to make you cry, and that is the compulsive blood tests of anybody that's involved in an accident that has an injury in it. Another point I'd like to make is that it's hard for the police to police these things when they're made such a farce of in court.
Yeah, yeah.
And they're having such a hard time policing themselves. I wonder how many policemen go home in the same state as a lot of the drivers they charge.
Well, I don't know. That's a kind of generalized slander, but I take your point.
Generalized slander, Jack. If you go down to the club on Main and Alexander, make up your own mind. That's all
what,
I wanted to say.
What club? What club?
The police club,
the police
Jack.
Club.
Oh, the one in the new building?
Yes.
Oh, I didn't know there was a drinking club there.
Surely you jest.
Thanks. Surely I do jest, as a matter
anyway,
of fact.
Anyway, it's quite easy. All you need is a compulsory blood test, and that'll solve the whole situation.
Thank you. I think the guy is pretty... Where there is an injury, there must be a compulsory blood test.
I think so.
The accused can have a copy of the blood, too, and have his own test, and even that might survive this hairy-fairy charter of rights.
Yeah, but one of the sad things, Jack, is when a person's killed, the prosecutor will say, oh, we'll get him unimpaired, don't you worry, we'll get him unimpaired. No mention that there's somebody killed. We, in fact, have been told the death is irrelevant in our trial.
Give me that again.
The judge said, in fact, that the death... The fact that a young man died in this accident is irrelevant to the charges.
Well, I suppose you've got to take one step backwards and say that a man is innocent until proven guilty.
Now, what he's saying is their only crime is the fact that they went out and got drunk. The fact that somebody got killed was...
Yes, they're innocent until proven guilty, Jack, but the point that we'd like to make is that we feel that they always mitigate the charges. When the charge should be manslaughter, they bring it down to impaired driving, and if it's impaired, they take it down further to dangerous driving.
And of course, the chances of being impaired if you have a good lawyer are, from the accused point of view, probably better than even money.
Yeah. Oh, yes.
Would you think you'll ever drink and drive, love?
No, never. Not after I've seen my friends.
Isn't that
killed.
Encouraging, Jack?
Yeah.
We've got a lot of
go ahead, please.
Yeah, hi. I'm just phoning in to give a lot of support to the people here who are presenting this and to your program for bringing this on. I'm saying this for my friend who died and also for myself. I'm missing a kidney and a spleen and a rib and a good portion of my bowel due to a drunken driver who hit me in Courtney about 3 years ago. And he was brought up on criminal negligence charges, manslaughter, and was found guilty. But due to the fact that he was 55 years of age, he was fined $500.
$500?
$500.
He was found guilty?
Yes.
Of motor manslaughter, more or less?
Yes. And the police told me, even before the trial was very far underway, that there was no doubt that he was guilty and no doubt about that.
Well, and the fact that he was 55 had nothing to do with the severity of the punishment.
It did. They said the only problem was the judge would have trouble figuring out where to put this person because he's 55 years of age.
Put him in jail.
Yeah, well, that's what I kind of figured about. What I was really more interested in was that the priorities that we seem to use for one another, for educating one another, are really kind of very screwed up when this kind of thing is allowed and when the person is no other forms of things like taking his car or his license.
I've got to break you there, but I'm grateful for your call. You've reasonably recovered, have you?
Yeah, I'm doing a lot better. You know, I'm married now and relaxed.
Much obliged for your call. I'll be back after the break. M.A.D.D. has branches just now in Victoria, Vancouver, and Richmond. They'd like them everywhere. So if you want to start one or inquire, there's the address once again. Now, tomorrow, what have I got? Tomorrow, Steve's been talking to Plimpton. Peter Newman's coming, and we're doing a piece with Kofi on the sanctions that U.S. softwood lumber manufacturers want to impose against B.C. The Lord help us if they do. Tomorrow at 9 a.m. precisely. Peter Newman, note taker for the rich, and Webster at 9 a.m. precisely.